Hey, it's Leo. Welcome to my channel. Today we're going to be doing the book cover telephone tag. This is a book tag that was created by Elizabeth at Reading Riley, and I was tagged by Craig and David at Shelf Possessed. I'll link both those videos down below, and I encourage you to check them out. This tag was created because Elizabeth at Reading Riley was noticing there's a lot of similarities in book covers. So she thought she would come up with a challenge where you had to start with one book cover, and then based on the colors, image, elements, font, or words, content of the book, then you linked it to another book, and so forth until you've done 10 books. And that's your telephone book tag. If you want to make it even more challenging, you start your first book linked to the last book of the person who tagged you, which is what I've done. But you'll have to watch Craig and David's video to see what the last book is of theirs and see how it links to my first book. I realized I was going to do some like thumbnail screen grabs, pretending that I was answering my phone, but I film on my phone, so I don't have that. I know, I will. One second. Thank you for calling the telephone book tag tech support hotline. This is Leo. How may I help you? I also want to give a huge thank you to all of the new people who have subscribed to my channel recently. I think many of you may have come from Sean the Book Maniac's Bite-Sized Book Chats, episode 44, where I gushed about Zane Jukidar's book, The Map of Salt and Stars, which I definitely recommend you check out, and check out Sean's other guests on that video. So thank you for coming to check out my channel, and welcome, and hope you enjoy. Also, I had to share that today I took my mother to the Oregon Symphony, and we heard a beautiful concert. We heard some pieces by Respighi, including Ancient Airs and Dances and Pines of Rome, and then this incredible world debut of a new arrangement by Natalie Joaquin, Suite from Femmes d'Haïti, which is Women of Haiti, and that was incredible as well. I'm going to link some other works of hers that you can check out. She shared with us about the beautiful community she has there and the seven generations and counting farming that her family has been doing, and there were some clips of children singing and her grandma in some of the pieces and that she sang with and the symphony accompanied, and it was stunning. Then the last movement of the Pines of Rome, oh, I mean, the whole thing was great, but like, whew, it was phenomenal. So my question for you is, has there been a recent live event that you've attended that was really fun or powerful? Or over the course of forever, what is a really fun and powerful event, musical concert or other live event that just really invigorated you, energized you, inspired you, etc.? I'd love to know and live a little bit vicariously through you. And I wanted to share a little bit about how awesome the symphony was today. So thank you. With each video on my channel, I lift up a different nonprofit that's doing good in the world. I do this to remind myself of all of the people who are working for good in the world, even when sometimes it doesn't look like that's the case. I'll make a donation and I encourage you to check them out. Like, share, follow, or donate as you are inspired. My donation this week is inspired by my reflection on the 101st anniversary of the Tulsa Massacre, which happened between May 31st and June 1st, 1921 in Tulsa, Oklahoma. This is something that I didn't learn about until a couple of years ago, which shouldn't surprise me, but still angers me. In this event, the white populace, aided and sometimes armed by local officials, looted and burned down 35 city blocks of the Greenwood District of Tulsa, Oklahoma, which was also known as Black Wall Street for its prospering Black community. They leveled the place, including homes, churches, schools, a hospital, a library. Up to 300 people were killed, and the National Guard detained over 6,000 Black Tulsans in the fairgrounds, and they couldn't be released until they had a white person to vouch for them. It's not surprising but disgusting that no charges were ever filed in this heinous and violent massacre. Reflecting on this anniversary, then I was looking up different nonprofits in Tulsa, and I found this really great nonprofit which aims to normalize the Black queer experience in Tulsa and create environments that are safe and welcoming and a strong community. And this was Black Queer Tulsa. Their vision is to be a pillar for Tulsa's Black community. Black Queer Tulsa believes in the power and impact that Black and queer people bring to the spaces they occupy and hearts they encounter. When we come together, they say, we change Tulsa and the world in unimaginable ways. And it's really exciting. So June is Pride Month, and Black Queer Tulsa is hosting Tulsa's first Black Queer Pride Festival, and this coming weekend, June 10th through 12th, 2022. The Black Queer Proud Festival is a celebration of and for Tulsa's queer community, specifically Tulsa's Black queer community. They are proud to center the weekend's events in the historic Greenwood District as a way to showcase the richness of Tulsa's Black history and thriving community. So I was really inspired by this organization, and I love different ways to celebrate Pride. So I'll make a donation. I encourage you to check them out. I also wanted to share this new t-shirt that I got for Pride, which says queer justice is intersectional. So thank you to Black Queer Tulsa and for all of the organizations and individuals that are helping us celebrate Pride, helping us to seek intersectional queer justice, helping us to make the world a welcoming, affirming, and loving place for everyone. Happy Pride! Okay, let's get to the book tag. As I mentioned, I'm going to start my book one linked to Craig and David's book 10. And my book one is one that I found based on Margaret Bertard's channel. I can't remember which one that she had this on. I'll try to find it and link it down below. But that is A Writer's San Francisco, A Guided Journey for the Creative Soul by Eric Maisel, drawings by Paul Aladana. It has this beautiful cover with the Golden Gate Bridge and the city and the mountains behind it. And this is basically a book talking about the how and why of an artistic pilgrimage for writers to San Francisco, and has all sorts of tips and essays and historical bits and so forth. So anyway, I love this cover, and this is my book one. And I found a really good one to link to for book two. You might see some common features in this cover, including a very similar view of the city and the bridge. So book two is The Days of Anna Madrigal by Armistead, Maupin, and this is book nine in the Tales of the City series, which many folks know. It's a classic. Most recently, you can see the adaptation of, I believe this one maybe, on Netflix. I haven't actually read these. I own three of the series. This one I got at a book signing here at Powell's Books here in Portland, Oregon, and it is signed. So that was very exciting. So I will, these are on my TBR, and I will get to them someday. And I would love to know, have you read any of the Tales of the City? I guess I didn't tell you what this is about, but in this book, Anna Madrigal, who is the legendary trans woman landlady of this home in San Francisco, is going to go on a road trip that takes her deep into her past. So it does look very good. So I'm going to keep with the theme of city with a mountain in the backdrop, but I'm going to shift cities and go with this book here. This is the Beadworkers stories. This is a book of short stories by Beth Piatote. She is a Nez Perce writer, scholar, and Indigenous language activist. And this is a collection of short stories that have unifying themes on the strength of kinship, the pulse of longing, and the language of return. It is formally inventive and filled with vibrant characters. The Beadworkers draws on Indigenous aesthetics and forms to offer a powerful, sustaining vision of Native life. And this I put on my TBR after seeing it on the list for the Indigenous Reading Circle, which I didn't get to it yet, but it looks really good. So I linked it to the next book because I don't know if you can tell very well on the screen here, but this is, it almost looks like a cross stitch or a needlepoint. It's probably, now that I think about it, it's probably beadwork of this scene. And so I have a similar book that is a kind of, I think this one is maybe a needlepoint, and that is The Seed Keepers by Diane Wilson. This book I mentioned in my March wrap-up and gave 5 stars. This is an intergenerational book following an Indigenous Dakota family and their struggle to maintain their way of life and also find family connection and community. And I definitely recommend that you read this one. So I saw the bee on this cover, and it called to mind the book cover that Donna Noble holds in her hands in an episode of Doctor Who, The Unicorn and the Wasp, which I mentioned a different time on this channel because I do love that episode. The cover that I have doesn't exactly match the edition that was held on that episode, but there is a bee on the cover. It has the US title, Death in the Air, instead of the UK title, Death in the Clouds. But you can see a bee. I think, I'm pretty sure that's a bee. And there's a bottle of poison, and it looks like a snake. And this is Death in the Air, or Death in the Clouds, by Agatha Christie, which was also adapted, which I have seen the adaptation, but have not yet read the book, but it looks pretty short. In this one, Hercule Poirot is flying with a group of folks across the English Channel, and the woman in seat two inexplicably dies. Of course, he's got to figure it out. So anyway, that is Oh, a first class ticket to terror, the back of the book says. I think we might have a different idea of what terror is these days. But anyhow, so that is book five, Death in the Air. So I struggled with what to pair this with, but I came up with that it's kind of an assorted elements that are possibly fatal. So, and also kind of a dark background. And so I linked it with Mrs. Pollifax and the Golden Triangle by Dorothy Gilman. And I don't know if you can see, but there's like a knife and a jar and maybe another knife. I don't know, my eyes aren't awesome. And so sometimes I couldn't exactly tell what some of these items were. In this book, number eight in the series, Mrs. Pollifax has given up spying, but does she? And then she agrees to carry one package to Thailand and bring another one back. But when she gets there, then her husband is kidnapped, her contact is murdered, and then she goes on this cross-country quest with this person that she has just met to try to find her husband and fix whatever crisis has occurred. Anyway, so I haven't read this one for a while, but definitely enjoy the series. And I looked at this cover, and I'm gonna kind of go again with that, like, small area of assorted items on the desk, and I am going to select for book seven, The Bat by Mary Roberts Rhinehart. Am I stretching it a little bit to compare those? I don't know. So this one I found out through Say Kevi, so check out her channel, and this is a mystery. I have not read it yet, but check out this synopsis. I have to read this one to you. An elite, rich, and spunky older lady rents a country house for the summer, along with her skittish Irish maid and her niece. Some servants sort of come with the property, but soon most abandon their new matron due to happenings within this large mansion. A converging plot concerns the homeowner, a banker, who has recently died and whose bank has just coincidentally failed. The suspicion falls upon a youthful bank clerk who is the heartthrob of the old lady's niece. The central plot revolves around the mysterious and effective murder burglar dubbed by the frustrated police as The Bat, and who has been operating in the vicinity of this country home. The subsequent happenings in this house are almost slapstick in nature in the old lady's efforts in solving the mystery of both the infamous Bat's activities and the bank embezzlement. So I definitely need to get to this. It sounds really fun and actually has a lot in common with this one in terms of like an older woman solving mysteries. So this is book seven. Now, you'll see there's a bookcase on here. And so I looked, I thought I had more books with bookcases on them, but I sadly don't. We'll need to rectify that. But I did find this one, which I'm currently reading. I just started. And that is The Department of Rare Books and Special Collections, a novel by Ava Jurczyk. You can see she's holding a stack of books there, so that's gonna be my link. I'm only on page 8 in this debut novel, but I'm really enjoying it so far. This is the story of Liesl Weiss, who is an assistant in the Department of Rare Books and Special Collections, and her boss has had a stroke, and so she's put in charge. But this rare item has gone missing, and then a librarian goes missing. And so she tries to figure out what is happening. Then there's this line on the synopsis, what Liesl discovers about the dusty manuscripts she has worked among for so long, and about the people who care for and revere them, shakes the very foundation on which she has built her life. Dun dun dun. So this one will hopefully be in my June wrap-up, but in the meantime, it is book 8 on my telephone book tag. All right, for the next connection, I'm going to take the element of the woman facing away from you, and I have this book that I got after hearing a wonderful interview on Margaret Pernard's channel with the author, Denny Bryce, and that is Wild Women and the Blues. So you see, again, woman facing away from us, in this case, wearing a fabulous gown. This is a book on my TBR, and it is a story told in dual timeline. In 1925 Chicago, Honoré Delcourt is a dancer in the jazz nightclub, the Dreamland. And then the other timeline is 2015, where a young film student, Sawyer Hayes, is at her bedside. She's 110 years old, and he's desperate to find out information about another person from the era, Oscar Michaud. And Sawyer, the film student, believes that Honoré, the dancer, is the only living connection to this guy, and he needs this information. And so then there's a telling back and forth of Honoré's story from 1925 and some unraveling about Sawyer's life in the 2015. The last few lines of the synopsis say, piece by piece, Honoré reveals her past and her secrets while Sawyer fights tooth and nail to keep his. It's a story of courage and ambition, hot jazz and illicit passions. And as past meets present, for Honoré, it's a final chance to be truly heard and seen before it's too late, no matter the cost. So that sounds really good. So I then, this last one is a little bit of a stretch, but I took the feathers here and kind of the loopy chain of necklace, and I'm tying that to Lava Red Feather Blue by Molly Ringle. And so this book, there's some feathers and chain up there. So you decide, is that a little bit too much of a stretch for you? Anyway, this gets us to book 10. This book I got from local author Molly Ringle at Yola Book of Load PDX. So I'll link to my book haul from that event as well. This story is about finding and waking up a handsome sleeping prince who's been enchanted, but at the same time then awakening a fairy who is determined to wipe out all human life. This story is about the prince and the man who woke him up and their alliance as they try to save the island. So it sounds really good. So that is my book 10, which links back to book 1. So that was really fun. What about you? Want to play book cover telephone book tag? Please consider yourself tagged, and I'm also going to tag a few people. I'd like to tag 3 fabulous channels: Kara at Wild Book Garden, Nikki at Red Dot Reads, and Berna at Berna's Bookish Adventures. So check out their channels, and I hope you enjoy doing this tag. This was a really fun scavenger hunt as I unearthed many books trying to find the covers that would connect. Thanks for watching. I look forward to continuing the conversation in the comments below, and I'm sending you wishes for hope, love, courage, and joy. Bye.